Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. As we gather this morning in the presence of God, we are welcomed, we are gathered around these words, grace and peace be yours through abundance in the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. This morning, we have joined together in this place. We have joined together as beloved friends and family of Paul van Engelenhoven to praise God, to witness to our faith, and to give thanks for the life of Paul. We've gathered together in sadness, we're acknowledging our loss, and as we gather, we ask that God will grant us the grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow we will experience hope, and in death we will see resurrection. For dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restores our life. And in baptism, so long ago, Paul was sealed, marked by the Holy Spirit as Christ's own forever. As we gather together in worship today, we gather around words that were dear from John 3:16 to Paul as they are sung to us in this ministry of music, For God So Loved the World, by Serena and Julia.
Thank you, Serena and Julia, for leading us in that very beautiful ministry of music. We're grateful for your gifts and for sharing them with the family this morning. Please join me in prayer. God, our comforter, you are our refuge and strength, a helper close at hand in times of distress. You forgive what we have done and what we have left undone. Your mercy is from everlasting to everlasting. Help us so to hear the words of our faith, that our fear is dispelled, our loneliness eased, and our hope reawakened. May your Holy Spirit lift us above our natural sorrow to the peace and light of your constant love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. And all God's people said, Amen. Friends, hear these words from John 3, verse 16. Words that Serena just sung. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Is it any wonder that John 3:16 may be the most familiar text in all of sacred scripture, known by Jesus follower and non-Jesus follower alike? Grammatically speaking, the text is simple, straightforward, but when it comes to the terminology, to the vocabulary, well, the words themselves become incredibly significant. These are the big words that are at the very heart of the Christian faith. Words like God and love and world and gave and only and son and everyone and believes in eternal and life. For all their significance, however, these words don't come to us on their own. No, they arise out of a much larger context in John's gospel. They come in the midst of a teaching moment, an instructive interaction between Nicodemus, the Pharisee, and Jesus, the faculty, if you will. Jesus, the teacher. Nicodemus comes to Jesus by cover of darkness, presumably hoping not to be outed for his curiosity surrounding this religious rebel. And do you remember how Nicodemus addresses Jesus? He says, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Katie, bar the door. Because Nicodemus has just asked the quintessential question without asking any question at all, opening up a much larger reality, a reality in which Jesus references, quote, being born from above. Nicodemus, taking Jesus at his word, is confused. How can a person be born again? A fully grown adult, how can he or she re-enter his or her mother's womb? And Jesus explains, by water and the Spirit, he says, what is born of flesh is flesh, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. Now, poor Nicodemus, he shows up hoping Jesus can clear some things up for him, help him to understand. He's hoping Jesus will lean into the tradition, explain how Jesus' teaching aligns with the law and the prophets, and Jesus refuses to clarify. Nope, instead he confuses, speaks about being born from above, about the kingdom of God being received by those who are born of water and spirit. So much for clarity. At one point, Nicodemus, utterly stupefied, asks, how can these things be? Are you a teacher of Israel? Jesus asks him, and yet you do not understand these things. You see, Jesus goes on to explain that Nicodemus isn't going to get it. And Nicodemus isn't going to get it because he suffers from a stunted imagination. An imagination limited by the categories of earth. An imagination that can't comprehend the limitless reality of God's kingdom. A boundary crossing, breaking barrier kingdom characterized by colossal love. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. God is a God of love. God's love is big, gargantuan, cosmic, for the whole world. And God's cosmic love leads God to act. God gave generously, sacrificially. God's love gave his Son. And whoever receives this love, trusting this gift, believing in this Son, is granted the gift of life. Abundant life in the here and now, and eternal life in the time to come. Nicodemus, the teacher in all matters of law, becomes a student at the feet of Jesus, the teacher in all matters of love. God and love, giving and life. Vernie, I absolutely love the fact that this is our only text for the sermon at Paul's memorial service. I love the story you told us on Saturday afternoon at the funeral home. Paul had listed several musical selections that were meaningful to him, and then when you asked him about a favorite scripture passage, he had only one. I like John 3:16. You pressed him. He didn't budge. I like John 3:16. Knowing Paul, he probably followed up with something about how he didn't want Mike to preach too long, so let's not give him too much material to work with. But you didn't mention that part, probably trying to spare my feelings, which Paul most certainly would not have done. All in good fun, of course. In all seriousness, I love it that he kept coming back to the same text over and over and over again. God and love, giving and life. If you were to ask a person to tell Paul's story using only four words, I'm not sure that you can do any better than these. God and love, gave and life. Now, for the sake of this message, however, I'm going to take them in reverse order. Elizabeth and I became pastors of American Reformed Church in January of 2015. It didn't take us long to get to know Vernie and Paul. On one of our very first Sundays in American, Vernie introduced herself to our girls and made a special connection with our eldest daughter, Nariah. She would eventually become Vernie's prayer partner, the two entering into covenant relationship, committing to pray for each other. It's one of the very best things about American Reformed Church, these intergenerational bonds of sacred connection. Now, truthfully, I don't remember my first interaction with Paul, but I can virtually guarantee you it involved him giving me grief on a Sunday morning before worship. Probably something about not getting too carried away, something about making sure the service didn't drag on ad nauseum, something about making sure the sermon wasn't a sleeper, if you know what I mean. And he didn't rib me just once, he did it every single Sunday. And I loved it. I can still see him sitting with Vernie near the back on the east side of the sanctuary. I'd walk in, say good morning, shake his hand, and wait with the eager anticipation like a kid in a candy store for his good-natured grief-giving. That fall, we'd bond over our love for the Iowa Hawkeyes, those mighty, powerful Hawkeyes, as Paul would call them. As a lifelong Hawk fan, I loved that he called them that because, well, more often than not, those Hawkeyes are not so mighty, nor are they very powerful. Hey, Mike, how about you slip in a prayer for those Hawkeyes this morning? They need all the help they can get. And then he'd start to laugh. That big, boisterous, full-bodied Paul von Engelenhoven bouncing up and down laugh, a laugh that I'd witnessed nearly every time I interacted with him. Early on, I discovered what anyone discovers when they become Paul's friend. Paul loved life. He treasured it, considered it a gift. He didn't take it for granted. He invested himself fully in it. Dale, I love how you said it on Saturday. People often talk about whether someone is a glass half empty or a glass half full kind of person. Well, Paul was a glass all the way full kind of person. And indeed, he was. Even in recent years, when his heart weakened and his breathing became more belabored, Paul found a way to approach every day with joy. At times, Paul would admit to me that he was down. He struggled with being confined to his apartment at Landsmere, not being able to be out and about with family and friends. And in the very next breath, he'd flash his smile and tell me how fortunate he was, how the meals were excellent at Landsmere, how Vernie was such a wonderful nurse, even though, based on her restrictions, he was less favorably inclined toward her as a dietitian, and how Orange City was basically the best place on the entire planet. Paul embodied this fundamental truth. Life is a gift of God. Every day, every moment, every nanosecond. The God who loves the world gave his only son so that we may have life, abundant, exuberant, joy-filled life in the here and now, and eternal, ecstatic, everlasting life in the time to come. Paul was a giver. Financially, he was generous, of course. It was an important lesson. His parents taught him this concept of giving. Just before Elizabeth and I arrived on the scene at American Reformed Church, the ARC Financial Stewardship Commission led a church-wide series on generosity. As part of that series, the church asked for volunteers who would share their stories of generosity, and Paul gladly and willingly did so. His talk on tithing must have been impactful because later on, Elizabeth and I learned of more than one family who were so inspired by his words that they themselves began giving 10% of their income to the life of the local church. Paul was generous, and he would often share the story about being challenged with a gift for a capital campaign at Northwestern College. When the college presented their ask, Paul and Vernie were a bit taken aback. It was way more than they had been prepared to give. But instead of saying no, they committed to praying about it. And even when they didn't know how they were going to come up with the resources, they believed that God was calling them to take a step of faith. So they pledged the amount that was asked of them. And by God's grace, they were able to fulfill that pledge. I love that story because it gets at the heart of generosity, does it not? Sometimes we think of generosity in terms of the way it benefits the recipient. But Paul and Vernie, too, understood that more often than not, the most important benefactor in generosity is the one who's called to give. Generosity is not what God wants from us. It's what God wants for us. Sally, I love the story that you told of your dad in more recent months when his health was declining. And even then, even when his health was declining, even when he knew he was coming to the end, he asked you, Sal, do you know of anyone I can help? I just want to do something for someone. But generosity of resources was only part of Paul's commitment. He lived with a generous spirit, always ready to offer an encouraging word, always willing to pay someone a kind compliment, always eager to offer a piece of sage advice. His was a generosity of spirit, rooted in gratitude for the God who had so generously given the gift of his only son, Jesus. Love. Now, to be sure, Paul had several material loves. He could talk to me for hours about his love for cars. He, of course, loved his motorcycles and the many times he experienced God's creation on his bike. He loved camping with his RV, and he regularly told me about his love for food. Even in recent months, when he was in declining health and I'd ask about his appetite, he'd get a really serious look on his face, look me in the eye, and say, "You know, Mike, that's quite something. You're never going to believe this, but all my life, I've never struggled to eat." And again, the big, boisterous, bounce up and down Paul van Engelenhoven belly laugh. But for all his material loves, it was crystal clear to me that what Paul most loved was people. Nearly every time I visited with him, Paul talked about people, people he met through the agency, people who worked for him, people who worked with him, people whom he met through his work and people he met through his civic commitments, people he became acquainted with through his investment at Northwestern College, and people he grew to love here at American Reformed Church. Nearly every story Paul told me involved another person, and nearly every time he'd talk about how deeply he appreciated people. I never had a cross word with him. And we worked together for 20 years. We never once got in an argument. And we were brothers. And I love the way that it reads in the obituary. Paul's outgoing personality and genuine interest in others was a natural fit for sales. Indeed, he was genuinely interested in others. Paul loved people. And most especially, he loved his family. Though I wish it were true, it's simply not the case that I know the names of every parishioner's child, grandchild, and great-grandchild, but I do with Paul and Vernie because they spoke of you so often. Sally and Brent, Mary, whom Paul, and only Paul affectionately called Josephine, and Dale, Devin and Emily, Blake, Emma and Dustin, Olivia, Caden, and Georgia. Mary, you said it well, family was everything to him, and that is so true. Even in declining health, even when he didn't feel up to it sometimes, Paul gave it his very best effort to attend every family get-together he could. And why? Because he loved you. It was important to him. Vernie, his playful banter, back and forth with you was one of the most beautiful things I've ever witnessed, a sign that neither of you took yourselves too seriously, and a sign of your deep and abiding love for each other. Don't miss this, and don't mistake this. Even if you told Paul you loved him, and even if Paul's only response was the feeling's mutual, know that his reticence for using the word was a respect for the weight of the word. Paul loved and loved well, you and us, and Paul's love was simply a sign of the love he saw in the God who gave Jesus so that we might have life. And God, we all know of religious name droppers, don't we? You know those folks, people who pepper every conversation with what Eugene Peterson calls unnecessary God talk, so as to maintain all religious appearances. I think it was Brent who said it on Saturday. Paul lived it. He didn't need to talk about it all the time. Paul was not a religious name dropper. When he spoke of God, which he did, he meant God. When he named Jesus, he did so with the significance of the salvation the name carries. Paul was deeply committed to his Christian faith, and he knew that faith was best lived out in the context of covenant community. When Paul and his family moved to Orange City as a kid, they joined American Reformed Church. And just last week, Paul told me how proud he was to be a member of this congregation. "That church means so much to me," he said, "and it means so much to me because we're different. We're not like any of the other churches in town." He's referencing our intentional, though never perfect, desire to be a place of refuge and welcome for those who may not find refuge or welcome elsewhere, the outsider and the outcast, the ostracized and the marginalized. Paul's God was big enough to welcome all. And I think he believed that to be so because he had experienced God's welcoming embrace in his own life. Truth be told, if all of us were able to see God's love as deeply as it is so for each and every one of us, maybe we'd welcome any and all just like Paul did, just like Vernie does. Several weeks ago, Dr. Hansen had stopped by Paul's hospital room to share some hard news. By providence or chance, depending on how pious you are, I stopped in Paul's room just 15 minutes later to pay him a pastoral visit. I could tell Paul was down. The doctor was just here. "It's not good news. My heart isn't going to make it." "How are you feeling, Paul?" "Well, I'm a little down about it, a little worried for Vernie. But you know, I'm ready to go." And then he said this, "I'm on good terms with God. Jesus and I, we've always had a good relationship. I know some struggle with doubt, but I guess I never have. I just know." I love it that in one of my last conversations with him, Paul named his origin and his end, the source and the goal of all of life. And all of it came from God, and all of it finds its end in God. Because of God's colossal love for the world, God gave God's only Son, Jesus. And the promise is that everyone, everyone who believes will live eternally with him. It's Thursday, but Sunday's coming. It's Lent, but Easter's coming. Earlier this morning, the family stood at the graveside at West Lawn Cemetery, where together we confessed what we believe. And what we believe is that we believe in the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. Today we grieve Paul's death, but we do so in hope, believing in the promise of the resurrection, that good and glad and glorious day when Christ will return and raise us to life eternal. So thanks be to God for the life and witness of Paul van Engelenhoven, one who lived and loved and gave. And thanks be to God that through Jesus Christ, Paul's most oft-repeated phrase is actually true. Paul is with Jesus. Death is past. Pain ended. Truly, he's never had it so good. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray together. For all the saints, O God, who from their labors rest, who thee by faith before the world confessed, thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Alleluia. Alleluia. Thou wast their rock, their fortress, and their might. Thou, Lord, their captain. In the well-fought fight, thou in the darkness drear, their one true light. Alleluia. Alleluia. O blessed communion, fellowship divine, we feebly struggle, they in glory shine, yet all are one in thee, for all are thine. Alleluia. Alleluia. O may thy soldiers, faithful, true, and bold, fight as the saints who nobly fought of old, and win with them the victor's crown of gold. Alleluia. Alleluia. But lo, there breaks a yet more glorious day. The saints triumphant rise in bright array. The King of glory passes on his way. Alleluia. Alleluia. From earth's wide bounds, from ocean's farthest coast, through gates of pearl, streams in the countless host, singing to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Alleluia. Alleluia. Amen. This time we welcome Elizabeth Ratliff Kinsack, who sings the number Because He Lives.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy He gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because He lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. And then one day I'll cross the river. I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory and I'll know He lives.
For sharing those words with us. Indeed, because he lives, we can face tomorrow. This time I'd like to welcome forward Dr. Robert Borcher, Bob Borcher, who is a dear friend of the Van Engelenhoven family, to share the eulogy.
Good morning. My name is Bob Borcher. One of the great honors of my life occurred a couple of weeks ago when Vernie called me and said that Paul had requested that I speak at his memorial service. I have such respect for Paul, and I admire him so much that I just hope that my reflections and words can bring him justice. Paul was a very, very good friend. Now, we all have that in common. Because Paul was everyone's friend. And no matter where you saw him, he was outgoing, he was friendly, and he was positive. And when you spent time with Paul, you always could find some reason to celebrate today, just like today we are celebrating his life. I learned so much about Paul and from Paul in the conversations I had with him and the stories that he shared with me. Now, what are some of the things I learned about Paul? Paul loved spending time at Okoboji in the summer, Arizona in the winter, riding his motorcycle, cheering for the Iowa Hawkeyes, and watching Monday Night Football. He believed in God. He believed in hard work. He believed in duty and loyalty to country. He thought it was important that we be conscientious and diligent in saving money. And he believed in the economic principle of supply and demand. He really loved all sports, but I think football was definitely his favorite. Recently, I found a photo of him in his Northwestern junior college football uniform, and I shared that with him. Now, if he was here today, he would probably tell you that he had helped establish the great tradition of Northwestern college football. Now, the fact is, the Red Raider teams of that era were really not very good. But Paul has been a fan and great supporter of the Red Raider athletic program, as well as Northwestern College, his entire life. When I began to coach the Northwestern men's basketball team in 1972, my roommate was Dan Cry. And Dan's parents, Mert and Gert, along with Fran and Bev Neiman, and Paul and Vernie, were gracious and welcoming to me. These people became lifelong friends, not only to me, but also to my wife, Mary. And Paul became a mentor and encourager to me. And I am sure that in his 85 years of life, all well lived, that he was a colleague, a friend, a mentor, an influencer, a difference maker, and an encourager to many of you. Paul was a very successful businessman. He indicated to me that he knew he always wanted to do something in sales. Now, that probably is of no surprise to any of us here today, as his personality fit that job perfectly. Paul could be persuasive without being pushy, and he would be confidently convincing in his conversations. And he built a very successful business that bears his last name, that has become, in my view, iconic here in Orange City. Every time I see a scoreboard or hear an ad on the local radio station for the Van Engelenhoven Agency, I think immediately, and I will always think, of Paul Van Engelenhoven. I learned that Paul had great respect and love for his parents, and he told me that his dad had such confidence in him that he was willing to co-sign on a loan to help Paul establish his first business. After a short time, Paul noticed that Everett would stop by each week, sometimes more than once a week, just to chat. And then, of course, to ask Paul, how many policies have you sold this week? Soon after, Paul approached Verge Roundhorse, the local banker. He told Verge that it was time for him to stand on his own 2 feet, and he would like his father's name and his dad's financial risk removed. Verge gave Paul that loan. Everett's weekly visits and questions ended, and of course, Paul, along with his brother Dave years later, built that very successful business. Now, Verge Roundhorse did not forget the confidence that he had demonstrated in Paul. When Verge, now president of Northwestern College, initiated his first call to commitment campaign, Mike, here comes the rest of the story, he approached Paul about a lead gift. Paul agreed, and he gave that significant gift, and he named it in honor of his father, Everett. I learned about the meaning of stewardship and the gift of giving from Paul Van Engelenhoven. Now, I learned how to have a good time and good laugh being around Paulie. In fact, there was more than one occasion that I would see him after we had been together, and he would ask, did we have too much fun last night? And then, before I could even respond, we would hear that hearty laugh of his. Paul was a role model for me, and I learned much about parenting by watching him interact with Sally and Mary when they were growing up. He often expressed to me his love and appreciation for each of you and your individual gifts. He loved you both, but he would often remind me he did not have a favorite. I learned the value of a good marriage by observing Paul and Vernie. Mary and I had so much fun with them, and I tried to emulate Paul in the care and concern he demonstrated for his wife. Vernie, he loved you so much. I learned from Paul that one of the great joys in life is being a grandparent. He spoke often about his grandkids, the conversations he had with Devin and Blake, or the fun he had interacting with Emma and Olivia. Now, I haven't heard much about Georgia, but I understand that Caden can throw a ball with such velocity and accuracy, the Minnesota Twins should be scouting him right now. And I think everyone here who has been blessed to be a grandparent would agree with Paul. his grandparent, his grandchildren were a great joy to him. I learned the importance of service from Paul. In addition to serving on a number of boards and committees here at the church and also in the community and at Northwestern College, Paul served as the Sunday school superintendent here at American Church. When he approached me one year and asked me to teach the senior high class, now, I didn't want to do it. But yet, I could not say no to Paul. Somehow, I made it through that year. I don't know if it was a good experience for the students, but it was a good experience for me. Now, Paul and I have not lived in the same community for 41 years. But it didn't make any difference if I had not spoken to Paul for a week, for a month, or for several months. As soon as we began to talk, we were immediately connected again. In recent months, Paul and I continued our visits, and although he was struggling with his health, our talks were not only meaningful, but they were reflective, and they were lots of fun. He expressed to me how much he missed his brother Dave. They worked together for all those years, and as Paul stated, never had a cross word. Now, having observed the dynamics of brothers in many families over the years, I think that is quite remarkable. I envision that Dave was among the first to greet him, along with his parents, when he arrived home last Friday morning. Vernie, Sally and Brent, Mary and Dale, Devin, Blake, Emma, Olivia, and Caden, I am looking forward to the day when I will see your husband, your dad, and your grandpa again. And I believe when I meet him in heaven, he will greet me with an enthusiastic, "Hi, Bob." And I will say to him, "How you doing, Paul?" And he will respond, "I never had it so good." Friends, you may ask, do you really believe that? I want to tell you, I not only believe it, I'm counting on it. Today I give thanks for a man of faith, family, and great wisdom, and for the extraordinary, meaningful, and well-lived life of Paul Van Engelenhoven.
Thank you, Bob, for sharing those lovely words. Beautiful tribute to a life well lived. This time we also welcome Emma forward as she shares some words from the family. Oh, both of you? Okay, come on forward.
Thank y'all for being here to celebrate my grandpa. I wish grandparents lived forever. You will always hold a really special place.
You will always hold a special place in my heart. You're my best friend. You taught me to love unconditionally. You gave the best advice that I will cherish forever. The best advice you gave me was, may you live as long as you want and never want as long as you live. I miss you and will love you forever. Thank you for being my grandpa. I thought I was going to be smart with the never had it so good, but it's been mentioned a couple times. So if I can get to it here. I didn't think there was going to be any way possible to mention all of the memories and tell the funniest stories with grandpa without keeping everyone here all day. But the reality is that everyone knows the kind of person he was. It didn't matter if you were his friend or family, you knew how kind, generous, and funny he was. and what a big heart he had, and he gave to everyone so selflessly. There were so many examples throughout life that I thought to myself, I want to be like Grandpa when I'm older. One thing that stuck out to me the most towards the end was his never-ending positive attitude. We all knew it was there anyway. Through his response, you would ask him how he was doing, and it never failed to be, I've never had it so good. In one of the last few days with Grandpa, his pastors from the church came to visit, and while they prayed with him, they mentioned the end and the light. But as soon as they left, Grandpa was talking about the day he'd get to come home. Later that night, he sat with Caden and my kids, and he made plans with Grandma to make fresh orange juice with Caden when he got home. It still proved true right until the end, less than 12 hours when Grandpa would be called home, and his nephew Paul stopped in for a surprise visit after flying in from Colorado. Paul mentioned how the flight was, and they made small talk about being tired from the flight. Grandpa had not been awake for most of the day, but at the end of his drowsy conversation with Paul, he said, "Well, I'll talk to you later when you aren't so tired." Even though Grandpa was clearly the one worn out, he smiled and chuckled and almost refused to admit defeat and exhaustion through the visit. Because that's one thing Grandpa never did. He never gave up. I found a poem I thought was really nice for him. God saw that he was getting tired, a cure was not to be, so he put his arms around him and whispered, "Come with me." With tearful eyes, we watched him suffer and saw him fade away. Although we loved him dearly, we could not make him stay. A golden heart stopped beating, hardworking hands to rest. God broke our hearts to prove to us he only takes the best. After almost every visit with Grandpa, he would give you a big hug and whisper in your ear, "It's sure nice you got to see me." As I got older, I would joke back and try to tell him first before he got the chance to. "But you win this one, Grandpa. It was sure nice we got to see you, and I can't wait to see you again."
Thank you, Olivia and Emma, for sharing those reflections, your love for your grandpa. Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Oh God, the one before whom generations rise and pass away, this morning we praise you for all your saints who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we thank you for your servant, Paul van Engelenhoven. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful. We thank you for the grace that you gave him that kindled in him a love, a lifelong love for you, and enabled him to serve you so faithfully his whole life. We thank you that for Paul, death is now past, pain is ended, and that he has entered into the joy you have prepared for him. So now, give us here faith to look beyond touch and sight, and in seeing that we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, and Paul is a part, enable us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Into your hands, O merciful Savior. We commend your servant, Paul van Engelenhoven. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming, and receive him into the arms of your mercy, the blessed rest of everlasting peace. We pray all of this in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And together we say, Amen. Finally, we stand together to sing The hymn of our faith, Amazing Grace, that's number 502 in the hymnal in front of you. That's 502, Amazing Grace. We'll stand as we sing together.
Just a few moments, I'll offer the benediction. Following the benediction, we will hear one of Paul's most treasured songs, When the Saints Go Marching In by Louis Armstrong, and the family will exit and make their way to the lower level fellowship hall for a post-memorial service luncheon. You're all invited to follow along with them. There's an elevator right outside here. Otherwise, you can take the stairs down and make your way to the fellowship hall. Please go ahead and go through the serving line, find a table, offer a silent prayer of thanks to God for Paul's life and for the gift of food, and begin eating. And now the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace, now and forever. Amen.
Sisters and brothers, this is Reverend Satchmo getting ready to beat out this mellow sermon for you. My text this evening is When the Saints Go Marching In. Here come Brother Hickenbottom down the aisle with his trombone. Blow it, boy. Go ahead, brother Holmes.
that number when the saints go marching in.